Let me just clear up a few things. After the game on Sunday, I told you that Josh Freeman was our starting quarterback again on Monday. I reiterated that because he was. We made the decision organizationally that we're going to make a change at quarterback, and now Mike Glennon is our starting quarterback.
Folks, this is the Tailgate Show. I am your host, Mr. Wright, and unfortunately, we do not have my glorious, fact-filled co-host, the Field Chief, in the studio. He's actually stuck in traffic right now, and we've got a lot to discuss, and it's kind of surprising because it just seems like another week has gone by and not a whole lot has happened, but, you know, actually a whole lot has happened with the Bucks. We've got Bobby Rainey, our new offensive NFC Offensive Player of the Week. We've got Deshaun Golson getting suspended for not that big of a hit. Greg Schiano hang. We got a report from Detroit that Greg Schiano, quote unquote, hung up on reporters in Detroit after a question about MRSA, and that is being blown out of proportion. And Greg Schiano did not actually hang up on the reporters in Detroit. So we've got a little bit more Schiano controversy, but this one they're trying to manufacture, and it's the media doing what the media does, and we'll get into that. Darrell Revis is talking smack with Megatron, and that's kind of interesting because I've heard some theories about that, and I want to share those a little bit later with you. So yeah, we've got a lot that we can talk about today, and one of the big things that I want to start off with is the three Buccaneers that have made the semifinal ballots for the Hall of Fame. We've got Tony Dungy, Derek Brooks, and John Lynch all making the Hall of Fame semifinals, and I think that Derek Brooks is probably going to make it in on the first ballot. He could be a first ballot guy. I don't know how many times Tony Dungy or John Lynch have made it onto the ballots, but I'm not sure. Tony Dungy probably be a second ballot guy, and John Lynch might be a number two or number three. But you know, hey, we'll see how it goes. If all three of them make it, that would just be. That would be wow. We've also got Marvin Harrison on that list, and I think Marvin Harrison, he's a first ballot guy. Marvin Harrison, absolutely. He needs to go into the Hall of Fame. I mean, he was just a tremendous, tremendous receiver for the Indianapolis Colts, and I mean, him and Peyton Manning, I mean, what a duo. I saw this one video where they were talking about Peyton Manning and Marvin Harrison and the chemistry they had, and it was like, their bond and their understanding of each other was so second nature to them that there were times where they never even spoke, and they were still on the same page 110%. I mean, it was that impressive. And they've really helped each other's careers out. One of the questions that we had on Pro Football Chat, for those of you who don't know, Pro Football Chat is the page on Facebook that the field chief and I have. And if you want to join the group, it's a closed group, but it's a group page, and you can join. All you got to do is go to the look it up on Facebook, Pro Football Chat, all three separate words, and request to join the group, and we'll let you in. And we talk a lot of football. We pose a lot of questions. Like, for instance, this question that I'm going to pose, and you can call in for this question. Here's the question. Who is the better quarterback, Tom Brady or Peyton Manning? And you go ahead and call in. The call-in line is 727-441-3000. And that's the question. And I want to hear some of your answers, because it's a debate that can go on forever. I think at the end of the day that it might be Peyton Manning. That's like my gut feeling, that it's going to be Peyton Manning. Although a very strong argument could be made for Tom Brady, because Tom Brady hasn't had the types of receivers consistently that Peyton Manning has had. But Peyton Manning has operated a few different offensive systems, and he's also played on two different teams and had success. So there's always that factor too. Tom Brady's only had the one team, and that team's always had a good defense, and you know, it's Bill Belichick. I mean, Bill Belichick and Tom Brady are probably the greatest coaching quarterback combo in the history of the NFL. I'm not even that big of, I don't even really care for New England at all. But, you know, I like the Dolphins, so it pains me to say that they are the best. I mean, who else out there currently, especially currently, has that kind of coach quarterback relationship? I mean, maybe Peyton, Sean Payton, and Drew Brees, maybe. And there's no question Sean Payton is an offensive guru, and you see how good of a guru he is in New Orleans. I mean, they haven't even missed a beat, and the guy was gone a year. You know what I mean? I mean, they had a great offense, but last year their defense was, I think, the worst in NFL history for against the pass. I mean, it was just bad. But they still found a way to win seven games. So there's something to be said for Drew Brees and for Sean Payton and that system that he's developed in New Orleans. So there's the question for you. I want to try and get to some phone calls a little later. I'll try and get the captain. You liked the captain, didn't you, last week, Cedric?
Yeah, man.
You liked it?
He's good. This thing, Tom Brady, Peyton Manning, this is who you think is better, not who you like better. Because, I mean, I know a lot of people hate
it. Who do you think is going to be the better quarterback at the end of their careers? Peyton Manning or Tom Brady?
Because people hate Tom Brady.
A lot of people hate the success.
Yeah.
They hate the success that Tom Brady has. And here's the thing about Tom Brady. I learned this years and years ago, and this is why I've never developed a full hatred for him. The man wants to win. He's got an impressive will to win. That's all he wants to do. He's won in life's marriage. I mean, look who he's married to. And look who his girlfriend was before that. You know, you know Bridget Moynihan, right?
Uh-huh.
I mean, she was an actress, a beautiful actress. If you don't know who that is, folks, she was in the movie I, Robot with Will Smith. And she was also in the movie The Lord of War. And she's pretty tops. And you got Bill Belichick. And a lot of people, you know, if you get hated, especially in sports, if they find a reason to hate you, it just means you're good. Look at LeBron James. Now, I think LeBron James gave a lot of people reason to hate him and how he treated the Cleveland Cavaliers when he left. But, I mean, that's a whole other story for a whole other sport and a whole other show. But it's a pretty interesting question. I mean, there's a few others. Like there's one that we did on the Pro Football Chat page. It was Who is the better quarter? Who would you rather, if you had a football team, who would you rather have as your quarterback? Joe Montana or, I'm drawing a blank. Denver. John Elway. Who would you rather have on your football team, John Elway or Joe Montana? And a lot of people gave their opinion on that one. And it was pretty strong. It was pretty one-sided.
Joe Montana, right?
Yeah, a lot of people said Joe Montana.
Yeah.
So, I personally went with John Elway. But there was a few other reasons besides the fact that I like Denver as well. Because I got family in Denver. So, I've kind of like, that's one of my offshoot teams is Denver. So, I went with John Elway because John Elway did what Joe Montana was able to do. And he did it without Jerry Rice. Because Joe Montana had a stacked team in San Francisco. Year in and year out, they were stacked. They had a great defense. They had Jerry Rice, the greatest wide receiver of all time. And, you know, look what Jerry Rice did. Jerry Rice didn't make one quarterback. He made two. Because he also did it with Steve Young, too. But let's not take away everything from Joe Montana either, because Joe Montana was Joe Cool. He had the composure and the confidence that you need in a quarterback that can bring you back in games. And he did it a few times. He even did it in a Super Bowl once. I think it was his rookie year he did it. Or his rookie or his second year where he took in the Super Bowl, he took the 49ers to win the Super Bowl. Against the Cincinnati Bengals in the last 2 minutes of the game. He did a two-minute drill, and that kind of solidified him and put him on the map. So Joe Montana is very good leading quarterback. He's the kind of guy you want to have as a quarterback leading your team, no doubt about it. So That was the question. We like to pose those questions. We do it with all kinds of different players, and we'll also ask, you know, do you remember this guy? Do you remember that guy? And, you know, it's always a lot of fun. So, for right now, we got the Bucks. And here's what I've heard about the Bucks, folks. Here's what I've heard about the Bucks. The locker room atmosphere has changed. It's changed somehow. And they're a lot happier. They're a lot looser. They're having fun. So I would expect, I don't know if the Bucks are going to win. And I will say this. Me betting my beard stands. If the Bucks win out the rest of the year, I'll shave my beard. I think they might be able to do it. They have the possibility to do it. But I don't think they're going to. Which is why my beard is safe. My beard is safe, folks. But we're going to be playing the Lions this weekend. We're going to be doing it without Deshaun Golson. Which, that could be pretty big because we're going up against Megatron. And Megatron is, I mean, he's this generation's Jerry Rice. He's the reason why we know the name Matt Stafford. I don't think we would know the name Matt Stafford if it wasn't for Megatron. not trying to take away stuff from Matt Stafford because he's a decent quarterback. But you're throwing to Megatron. I mean, that's the guy lit up 320 something yards against Dallas. I mean, that's just who does that, you know? So we're going to be missing Deshaun Golson, and he's a Pro Bowl player. That's going to be huge. We've got Jarrell Revis, and I got into an interesting conversation today. It was wild. The guy was a huge homer for the Philadelphia Eagles. I mean, he's like, you know, the bad Philadelphia Eagles fans. He's this kind of Philadelphia Eagles. He's one of the bad fans. He's not one of the happy-go-lucky fans. Again, there's not too many of those, but for some reason, I've seemed to run into a lot of the happy-go-lucky Eagles fans here in Tampa when they're here. But this guy isn't one of those guys. And he was sitting there trying to say how irrelevant Darrell Revis was. And I was blown away. I was like, how can you sit there and say that against Darrell Revis? The man has accomplished a few things. Number one, the title, Revis Island. Number two, lockdown corner. He's the kind of guy you put up against an opposing team's best receiver, and he shuts them down. And it's true. That's what he does. It's what he gets paid to do. The last time you went up against Megatron, Megatron was only targeted 4 times, number one, and only got 1 pass out of it. He can shut Megatron down just because Megatron's taller or, you know, whatever else. That doesn't mean nothing. And also, we've got hard hitters in the backfield, too. And that's where DeSean Golson comes in. We're going to be missing DeSean Golson this week. And he's one of our hammers. But we've got another hammer in the backfield. We got Mark Barron. So, I don't know how much of the slack Mark Barron will be able to pick up, but I know that he's having a Pro Bowl year. Same thing with Levante David. Our defense is looking somewhat exciting. I still think that we need more depth at the defensive line. And I think that's been one of the problems that we've had on the defense whenever we do have problems. What was that in there, Cedric? What's going on?
Oh, sorry about that. I got a call from the station owner. It's a busy day, man. I've been like doing like 20 things at once.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I know. It's crazy.
It's crazy. Yeah, I saw you running around the last show. I was like, whoa, what?
Oh, my God, man. Killing me. But it's okay. It's winding down towards the end of the day.
Winding down towards the end of the day.
For me.
Yeah.
For me.
Oh, that's good. That's
for everyone
good.
Else. But no, we're still good. We're still on track. Where is he, man?
He's stuck in traffic. He said that he was on I-4.
Oh.
So I don't know if he's going to be able to make the show.
Yeah, that might not happen.
I don't think he's going to be able to make the show because that's quite a ways away. And basically, I don't think this is going to happen again, folks. Don't worry. Phil Chief, he won't be here this week, but he'll be here in 2 weeks. That's another thing I wanted to talk about right before we go to the break.
Hey, you know, he should call in. We'll get him on. If 866-826-1340. Call in.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I'll send him a text message during the break. Let's take a break here, Cedric. Come on,
let's
man.
Let's do it, man.
Yeah, let's do it. Let me get some of these ducks lined up.
Hey, sports fanatics, it's Mr. Wright here from The Tailgate Show. Let me tell you about my media production company, Just Wright Productions. We specialize in media production ranging from commercials to wedding and event videos to corporate events and training videos. We can even help you with your independent film. Hey, maybe you just want some video footage edited professionally. Let's talk about it. Contact me, Mr. Wright, at 530-863-7776. That number again is 530-863-7776.
Has managing your business wireless phone accounts become an unwanted burden? Does it seem to be a never-ending battle to review invoices, optimize features, and replace smartphones? Tab Mobile Management can relieve you of this time-consuming chore and let you focus on your business. Find out how Tab can help. Contact Tab at info@tabcommunicationsconsulting.com or at 813-507-7300. That's 813-507-7300. And get a grip on your mobile devices.
Fourth down, coach. What do we do?
I'll tell you what we do.
You can take those Artie Fletcher comedy CDs and that Artie Fletcher book out to the center of the field and start a damn bonfire.
We will win this for Mother Russia.
Coach, have sex with Artie Fletcher.
Why is that, Chief?
You get a little loopy when you're horny.
Better.
You're not you until you've had sex with Artie Fletcher. You're also not you if you haven't listened to the Artie Fletcher Show, because he's on tonight from 8 until 10 here on the Tan Talk Radio Network.
My God, is he ugly.
You may be owed some money. After 911 and 411, call 541. That's 727-541-1741. Call Gulfstream Motorsports for a diminished value report. Due to my 28 years experience in the auto salvage business, I'm very good with wrecks. So if your car's been involved in a wreck, call me for a diminished value report. Call 727-541-1741. You may be owed some money for the lost value of your repaired vehicle. And visit us at GulfstreamMotorsports.com.
This is the Tan Talk Radio Network.
Hey, Cedric.
Yeah, man.
You like the little bumper rotation we put together?
Oh, your bumper music?
Yeah.
Yeah, you got all the old school hip hop beats, man.
Yeah, we got
not really old school yet, but I guess it's getting there.
Yeah, yeah. That's one of the strengths of my co-host. He's able to really spot some really cool bumper music. Yeah, and man. I was like, wow, this is pretty good stuff. Because he would forward it to me, and then I would put it onto my computer, because when we had the show at the other station,
yeah,
that's how we did it. We would just play everything off my computer, the commercials, everything.
So, are you serious?
Yeah, yeah.
You could do that here too, you know.
Oh, oh.
If you wanted to. I mean, I'm not saying.
Well, we've already got the stuff in the computer. Yeah, I mean, yeah, you know. As why change it now, you know?
Yeah.
Hopefully I'll be able to get more commercials into you.
I know. That's all good. Well, you know, we're still working on everything. It's a growing process.
And that's another thing, folks. I didn't really get a chance to explain the history of the show. And that's kind of an interesting little story. A few years ago, I was going to HCC, and I was in the radio and television program. That's my degree, radio and television. So I've got a college degree now with radio and television, and the head of the department, his name was Ed Erickson, and he's a great, great broadcaster. He became a teacher, and he's retired now, and he's living a retired life, and he's loving it. But he lives down in Sarasota. And so I was there when he retired, and as he retired, he wanted to bring some of the students to the radio station down there, and he's a football fan, and he likes the Miami Dolphins. And so he's down in Sarasota, and there's a lot of Miami Dolphins fans in Sarasota. They like Miami, and they like Tampa. They like both teams. And so he decided that he wanted to try out a football show with some of his former students, and he invited me and a few others. And so I go down there, and we start doing the tailgate show. We put it together. We spitball the idea. We come up with how we want to do it and all that good stuff. And so on Sundays before the game at 11 o'clock, those people are getting out of church, driving home. They would listen to the radio if they wanted to listen to any kind of sports stuff. And they would hear us talking about all the football games that were going to be happening on Sunday. And so that's how this tailgate show got started. And I had a lot of fun because, you know, last year a whole bunch of really fun stuff happened. We had a lot of laughs at the refs, the replacement refs, which is in our promo, you know? I mean, that's some of the you liked that, didn't you?
Oh yeah.
It was real funny. And so he helped us set the tone of the show. And the tone of the show, folks, is that we are just fans. We've got a little bit of radio training, but we're not professional broadcasters, not yet. And we're just fans.
You're not supposed to tell them that.
What do you mean I'm not supposed to tell them that? Why can't I?
Because, man, I mean, you are a professional broadcaster. That's what I was told when you came here.
I am.
They told me I better, you know, watch out because I might make a fool out of myself.
I doubt it. I mean, you've done great stuff for me so far. I'm like,
all right.
You've been on top of it. You've been on top of it more than I can say some of my fellow students in the broadcasting class. I mean, so, but that takes drive, and you have the drive to do it, and that's an amazing thing, and that's what gets things done in the radio world, folks. You got to have the drive.
That's
you don't have
right.
the drive, nothing gets done. And I've tried to explain that to some of my compatriots in my classes, but sometimes it stuck, sometimes it didn't. But anyway, so we technically, yes, we are professional broadcasters, but we're not sports pundits. I guess it's the better way to say it. We're not sports.
Yeah.
We're not the professional ESPN guys, you know? And so we approached it as fans, and that's what we think that's the voice that needs to be heard. And that's an important thing in radio. You want to find the voice that needs to be heard. And you want to make it heard. And so we're fans, and this is how we do it. We want to make sure that the fans' perspective gets heard. And we've had the training to do it professionally. And yeah, we technically, like I said, we are professional broadcasters, but we're also fans. We're one of you guys, you know. We're out there, we're watching the games, we're seeing the plays. We get the emotion level that the fans get. And we are biased. We've got bias. We got teams we like. We got teams we hate. I like the Buccaneers first and foremost. I also like the Miami Dolphins. They're my solid number two. Right next to the Dolphins is the Denver Broncos. I like the Denver Broncos. I always have. I've got, like I said, I got family out in Colorado, and I've always liked them.
I also like the New York Giants. I mean, some of these teams, some of them are doing good. Some of them aren't doing so good. The Giants are finally turning it around. My mom is from Pittsburgh. I like the Pittsburgh Steelers. So those are pretty much the teams that I like. So I'll talk glowingly about them. I think the least of those teams is probably New York and Pittsburgh. But I do like them. So I want to see them do good as long as they're not playing the Bucks. That's just how it is. So the Bucks are playing the Detroit Lions this week. We're going up against Matthew Stafford and Megatron. And it's going to be a test. We got to get after Matthew Stafford. If we're not going to be able to get after Matthew Stafford, it might be a long day. I think the Bucks are, they're 10-point underdogs. That still kind of blows my mind. You know, Detroit is a well-balanced team, yes. But the Bucks are improving. We're playing a lot looser. There's a different attitude in the locker room. I think that, I don't know if the Bucks will win. I'm not going to sit there and straight out pick the Bucks yet. I'm not comfortable enough with the Bucks to do that yet. Because I still think that, you know, I got to see consistency in the play-calling ability of Coach Schiano. Because Coach Schiano needs to win the rest of these games. He wants to save his job. That's the only way he can save his job. And even then, he still might not save his job. Because I think a little later, we're going to see maybe somebody else. I think that's what this losing streak has kind of put the Glazers off of his play calling ability, and that's the thing that he needs to change. But here's the rumors out of the locker room, and I've heard this from a few media sources. It has changed. He's starting to take advice from his players now. He needed to be doing that a little bit earlier, I think. I mean, you know, let Gerald McCoy run loose. Just let him loose. Don't sit there and try and keep him on stunts and stuff like that. Let him run loose. So, we saw what he did. He got, what, three sacks? Three sacks against Atlanta? Now, granted, Atlanta doesn't have a great offensive line this year. Their offensive line has fell apart, and that's the reason why they're 2-8, folks. So, and here's another thing. I've heard that he's starting to ease up on some of the control issues that he's got. He's letting some of the other coaches. He's still got final say on what plays are getting called, but here's the thing that I noticed about Greg Schiano the past 2 weeks, particularly against the Atlanta game. In the third quarter, he did not revert to his old ways until the end of the third quarter or the beginning of the fourth quarter. Atlanta started to move the ball. And that's because he went into a conservative, we got the game in the bag mode. Because we were up by an ungodly amount at that point. I think it was like 38-7 or 34-7 or something. I mean, it was up there. And so he went into conservative mode and Atlanta started moving the ball. He took out his starters. He went to prevent defense. And that's been my biggest complaint. Every time I saw him go into prevent defense, I saw the opposing team march right down the field and score points. Every single time. It absolutely frustrated the heck out of me, folks. The first time I saw him not do that, it was against the Miami Dolphins. He did two plays. He went into a prevent defense mode. Dolphins got a little confidence. And then all of the sudden, he let his defensive line loose, showed them plays that they didn't see the entire game. He held those plays back, got after Ryan Tannehill, sacked him two times in a row, lights out, game over. That's how you get it done, folks. When you are up and when you're winning, you put your foot on their neck and you start stomping. And that's what he did against the Miami Dolphins. And that's what he needed to be doing the entire season long. When we were up against the New York Jets, we needed to put our foot on their throats and stomp them. Who do we got? Who do we got?
We got Rob on the line in Clearwater.
Okay, Rob, what's going on? What you got?
Yeah, I was wondering how come you guys ain't talking about the big trade in baseball. Prince Fielder to the Texas Rangers for Ian Kinsler.
It's a football show, man.
Yeah, this is
baseball.
We primarily talk about football.
I got Detroit all over the Buccaneers Sunday.
Oh, you got detoured all over the Buccaneers?
Yep. The Bucs, they're done for the year. They ain't going to win any more games.
You think we're done for the year? I don't think so. I think we'll probably win about two or three more. I think we're going to win about two or three more, if not more than that. I think there's something different about the Bucs the past few weeks. We saw it 3 weeks ago when they played Seattle. In Seattle. I mean, yeah, granted, we lost the game and they came back, but Seattle's still a very good team. Okay. I mean, they're the number two team in the league right now. What did he say?
I didn't catch it.
Oh, well. Okay, Rob. Well, hey, hopefully, we can expand the show and we will start talking about the other sports because I've been starting to follow baseball a little bit. I haven't followed baseball since the 90s.
Now, maybe this is a dumb question because I'm not a sports guy. I'm an engineering geek. But do people tailgate at baseball games?
I don't know. I know they tailgate at football games a lot.
Oh, yeah.
I've heard that they sometimes tailgate at basketball games, and I'm not exactly sure what that's about. I'll have to get on with my co-host on that. But that was another thing that we did last year down in Sarasota was the tailgating. We talked a little bit about tailgating, you know, what foods we liked, what kind of beers we liked, stuff like that. I lived in Italy for a couple of years, 3 years actually.
Okay.
I lived in Italy for almost 3 years, and so I got exposed to some European beers, and those beers really impressed me. So I started going after the Belgian beers.
Yeah.
So there's a few Belgian beers out there that are really...
You're talking like the Trappist ales or something.
Yeah, the Trappist, ales. They're really smooth. They've been perfected over hundreds and hundreds of years.
Yep.
So you get a whole different element of beer making and beer styles. And the Belgians, this is what I learned when I was in Europe, the Belgians put the Germans to shame when it comes to beer. But that doesn't mean I don't like some American beers, folks, because there's a few out there. I like Leinenkugels. I'm finding I like Leinenkugels. Started off with a summer shandy because that came from the whole, you know, Belgian beer thing.
Right.
I would drink some of the flavored beers and I would try them out. And so when I found out about summer shandy, I was like, what is this? Lemonade and beer? Okay, I'll try it. I'll try things out. I will try things out. And when I tried it, I was like, wow, this is surprisingly good.
Yeah, it is pretty good.
And so I got turned on the Leinenkugels. And I every time I see a new Leinenkugel line in the store, I'll try it out. And I've never really been disappointed with their stuff. I've yet to find a beer that I don't like from them. So I like Leinenkugel. And that's an American brand out of Wisconsin, Chippewa Falls. And also, my favorite American beer is Yingling.
Yeah.
I didn't know that we had a Yingling.
Right over there.
Yeah, the Yingling plant.
Yeah, it's in the old
Busch Brewery.
Yeah, it's in the old Busch Brewery, yeah.
Yeah, it turned into the Yingling plant. I'm like, rock on. This is probably why it's cheap as heck here.
Oh.
Because they got no transportation costs.
Exactly. You know what's good? I mean, I know a lot of people don't like the IPAs, but the Hi-Li beer, it's Cigar City out of Ybor. Hi-Li.
Yeah, there's some pretty good crafting. Tampa's getting some pretty neat little crafted beers.
No kidding. Good stuff, man. Good stuff. I'm looking online to see if people tailgate at baseball. It doesn't really look like it's that common. I'm sure somebody does it.
Well, also you got to think about it. Like, you know, football is a Sunday thing.
Yeah.
Baseball happens all week long.
Right. Not conducive to tailgating.
Yeah, it's not. So, you know, they were at work that day. Maybe they were at work if they're going to an evening game or, you know, whatever. So it's not exactly. It's not a. It can't be the family get together like a football game can.
Yeah.
Or like the basketball game, because a lot of the basketball games will happen at night. But also with the basketball games too, there's another factor which is probably keeping them off the charts for tailgating. Is you could probably only do it towards the end of the season and maybe at the beginning of the season, at the very beginning. Maybe a couple of times at the beginning and only at the end because it's a winter sport. They play it inside, indoors. There's not a whole lot of people that go to them. I mean, you got a football game, you got four times the audience, you know. You got like 80,000 people there at the stadium, you know. So it's also a pretty big factor. And
Those are some of the beers that I like. Those IPAs. I'm not really... The only thing I don't like about IPAs, though, going back to your IPA thing, is they get kind of bitter in the aftertaste.
Yeah.
I'm not too much with the bitter on the aftertaste.
Yeah.
That's usually not my style. I like the... for some reason, I just... Yingling is by far and away my favorite. I just love it. I don't know why. I just love it. And so I've also tried other amber... lagers.
Right.
Because Yingling is an amber lager. And so I get kind of close in taste, but I still like Yingling the best. And hopefully in a few minutes, folks, we'll have the captain call in and we'll get to converse with the captain and see what he thinks about the change in the Buccaneers and all the upcoming game with Detroit, the loss of Deshaun Golson, Darrell Revis, and and all that stuff, the controversies and all that good jibber-jabber. So catch you on the flip side of this break, folks.
Hey, sports fanatics, it's Mr. Wright here from the Tailgate Show. Let me tell you about my media production company, Just Wright Productions. We specialize in media production ranging from commercials to wedding and event videos to corporate events and training videos. We can even help you with your independent film. Hey, maybe you just want some video footage edited professionally. Let's talk about it. Contact me, Mr. Wright, at 530-863-7776. That number again is 530-863-7776.
Has managing your business wireless phone accounts become an unwanted burden? Does it seem to be a never-ending battle to review invoices, optimize features, and replace smartphones? Tab Mobile Management can relieve you of this time-consuming chore and let you focus on your business. Find out how Tab can help. Contact Tab at info@tabcommunicationsconsulting.com or at 813-507-7300. That's 813-507-7300 and get a grip on your mobile devices.
Thousands of newspaper and magazine articles have been written about him. Countless TV programs have focused on him. Millions of arguments have been started because of him. Everyone has an opinion about him. The world will be listening as Ima speaks. Make sure your radio's tuned, that your alarm is set, as history waits for only one man, the I-Man.
The I-Man is back in Tampa Bay on the stations of the Tantalk Network. Catch Imus in the morning right here.
This is the Tantalk Radio Network.
Back, folks. This is Mr. Wright right here on the Tailgate Show on WTAN 1340 Clearwater. And we got Bobby Rainey, folks. We're going to get into some of the players and then also we'll try and close this out with the Hall of Fame selections and the 2002 Buccaneers. I want to talk a little bit about that because I watched... I bought the Tampa Bay Buccaneers Super Bowl DVD. You know, NFL puts out for every Super Bowl team every year. Whoever wins, they you know, a couple of months later, they give you the DVD and bring it out. And I watched that, and I had a blast. It was great watching it because it's something that we miss here in Tampa. We miss those winning seasons. We miss the winning. And, you know, it was great seeing Warren Sapp do his thing and go after people, and, you know, Derek Brooks with all of those TDs on defense, and I think we set a record that year for touchdowns for a defense. And that's the thing, folks. That's the thing. I'm starting to finally see that kind of playfulness in...
Favorite play.
Yeah.
Sorry.
I'm starting to see that playfulness again with our team and how loose they're playing. They're playing with a sense of fun,
Like this, you know, this is still, yeah, it's football, it's a business, it's serious stuff, but it's also fun, and it's why, it's like watching a kid play. Not only are they doing it because they want to win, but they're doing it because it's fun, and that's always exciting to see. And the one thing that we got to see was Bobby Rainey. This guy had been, you know, bounced around a little bit. He played with the Baltimore Ravens last year on that Super Bowl team. And he was called the mini Ray Rice. Now, Ray Rice played for Greg Schiano in Rutgers. So when you're comparing him to Ray Rice and saying that he's a mini version of Ray Rice, you probably might get a Ray Rice type performance out of him. And guess what? Check out Sunday. We did. We got a Ray Rice type performance out of Bobby Rainey. And I heard something interesting this week that I originally thought that it was our offensive line that was blocking really well, and it wasn't entirely the case. Apparently, it was Bobby Rainey. And after I figured out a few of the other pieces that were in play, number one, Greg Schiano's system, number two, mini Ray Rice, number three, Ray Rice played for Greg Schiano, and so it's the same type of system. Number three, Bobby Rainey ran the same system in college, so he knew the plays. He knew the blocking schemes. He knew what to look for in the setup. So all of those things came together, and it was one of those things that we didn't get to see a lot in the first eight games. We didn't get to see a lot of things, quote-unquote, come together. We saw a lot of things falling apart in those games. And so that's also another good thing, and I want to get a little bit more optimistic about the Bucs. We got the two wins. They were pretty great. We almost won that game in Seattle, which would have been absolutely huge because you don't go into Seattle and win. It's just not something you do, and we almost pulled it off. We're witnessing a change in the Bucs, a change for the better, and I personally want to see this change stay. I don't care if we go 8-8 or not a 7-9 or 6-10 and we don't get the number one draft pick. I don't care about the number one draft pick. I want to see my Buccaneer team win. I hear a lot of fans, oh, let's tank for Teddy. We don't necessarily need another quarterback. We've got a decent quarterback. Do I think he's going to be the answer? That remains to be seen. I've yet to see a great performance out of the guy. I've seen a bunch of good performances out of him. I've seen some mistake-free football out of him, unlike Josh Freeman. And I became a reluctant Freeman supporter towards the end. But you know what? I wasn't upset when we got rid of him. I knew just by the way Greg Schiano had constantly talked about Mike Glennon that he was Glennon's guy. And Mike Glennon hasn't really disappointed yet. I don't think he's performed as well as people are claiming he has, because I don't see a 300-yard game on the kid yet. I don't see an elite level of play. I see a game manager level of play. And I want to see an elite level of play. The thing that Tampa has always missed, we have never had, was an elite quarterback. You're Tony Romo, you're Tom Brady, Aaron Rodgers, Drew Brees, Joe Montana, Peyton Manning. We have not had that kind of quarterback. And that's the one I want to see. I want to see that. We thought we had it with Josh Freeman. And if I throw out last season's numbers, those were the kind of numbers from an elite quarterback. But there was something missing with Josh Freeman, and it had to do with his consistency. Because he would have those games where he would tank his completion percentage. And he'd have some games where he might not have thrown some interceptions in the one game where he had 35% completion. But then he'd have games where he'd have like close to 50% complete. But he would throw four friggin' interceptions in two games in a row. I mean, that killed us. That game last year, again, I will never forget that game. I was listening to it on the drive back from Sarasota because the show in Sarasota we had on Sunday, so I'd be driving back home when the game was on.
But that game, I was listening to it, and we were marching down the field. I'd hear Gene Deckerhoff just doing the play-by-play, and the Bucks would be marching down the field, and Deckerhoff was getting excited, and all of a sudden, as we cross the 50-yard line, we get into any enemy territory, bam, interception. And you take away those turnovers that we had in that game against New Orleans last year, and it wasn't a 41-0 game. It was more like a 24-27 game. And that would have still been a loss, but it wouldn't be 41-0 loss. And you take away those interceptions, and you actually turn those into some scores because we were marching down the field last year, it turns that 27-24 game in, depending on if we make one touchdown or not, turns into a 28-27 game where we win. And that game stuck with me. And that's when I really turned away from Josh Freeman. And I didn't come back to Josh Freeman until this season started. Because I looked at the entirety of his work last year, and here's what he did. 27 touchdowns. 4,000 yards. 18 interceptions. Yeah, the interceptions were a bit high, but how is that different from, say, John Elway back when he was playing? He had plenty of seasons like that. Plenty. And that guy's in the Hall of Fame. So we had a top 10 quarterback last year. And when he was on fire. But that was the problem when he was on, meaning he was also off. And when he was off, it became a disaster. And you can't have that. So in that regard, going with Mike Glennon has been somewhat of an upgrade. We're not having these games where the quarterback completely falls apart. And that's a good thing. The thing we hear about Mike Glennon is he's smart, he works hard, he's the first one in, last one out, he's studying games, he's studying offenses, he's studying plays, he's studying defenses, he is a cerebral quarterback. Just like Russell Wilson. And the reason why I brought up Russell Wilson was because they both had the same quarterbacks coaches in college. Russell Wilson ended up going with somebody else, though. He ended up swapping colleges halfway through his college career, and Mike Glennon took over for him. And Mike Glennon had an impressive, when he first started, it was an impressive year. He was slated to go in the 2012 draft, but he passed. Here's another little thing that's not well known about Mike Glennon. He passed on that. He passed on a 2012 draft because there were so many other great quarterbacks that were in that draft class, and everybody was talking about it. And he figured, I could be the great quarterback in the 2013 class. Only one problem. That next year, his receivers kind of sucked. And he was hitting a lot of the targets, but the targets were dropping the ball. And so his completion percentage dropped by a few percentage points. It was pretty big. And that was one of the comments I remember. The first time I ever heard Greg Schiano talk about Mike Glennon was, we drafted this guy because I wanted to know who this guy was. Why were we drafting a quarterback? We had Josh Freeman. That's what I wanted to know the first time I heard the guy's name. And then I saw Greg Schiano's press conference, and he was talking about why they drafted Mike Glennon. And one of the things that they looked at was, they were looking at, was he still hitting the targets? Yeah, his percentage completion dropped, but was it his fault or was it the receivers? And it also kind of spoke to Greg Schiano's attention to detail. And that's pretty significant, because we've got a quarterback and a coach that are kind of on the same page with one another. And good things can come of that. But I want to be perfectly clear on this, guys. I'm not exactly against Schiano, and I'm not exactly for him. I want to see consistency. I want to see consistency with good play calling. Not only good play calling for a certain part of the game and then go into conservative mode. I want to see, let's put our foot on their throat and keep stomping. Keep the foot on the gas and keep going. That's what I want to see. And that's what the fans want to see. That's what we saw
in the first half of the year last year. That's what we saw. We had finally had an offense. It was the Bucs' highest scoring offense in team history. And it was very, very impressive. All right, folks, we're going to have one last commercial break, and then we're going to go. I'm going to run through the NFL picks and tell you what I think and who's going to be, who are my picks for the week, and catch you on the flip side, folks.
Hey, sports fanatics, it's Mr. Wright here from the Tailgate Show. Let me tell you about my media production company, Just Wright Productions. We specialize in media production ranging from commercials to wedding and event videos to corporate events and training videos. We can even help you with your independent film. Hey, maybe you just want some video footage edited professionally. Let's talk about it. Contact me, Mr. Wright, at 530-863-7776. That number again is 530-863-7776.
Has managing your business wireless phone accounts become an unwanted burden? Does it seem to be a never-ending battle to review invoices, optimize features, and replace smartphones? Tab Mobile Management can relieve you of this time-consuming chore and let you focus on your business. Find out how Tab can help. Contact Tab at info@tabcommunicationsconsulting.com or at 813-507-7300. That's 813-507-7300. And get a grip on your mobile devices.
WTAN Clearwater, Tampa Bay. WDCF Dade City, Tampa Bay. WZHR Zephyr Hills, Tampa Bay. Listen.
All right, folks, we're back. Back for the last little segment, the picks. Here we go. New Orleans Saints and Atlanta Falcons. I'm going to pick the Saints, even though they're at the Falcons. And Atlanta can play New Orleans pretty good, but I don't know if they're eight-point favorites. That might be a little high, but I think New Orleans will be able to pull it out because, I mean, New Orleans is on fire this year. What can you say? We got the New York Jets at the Baltimore Ravens. The Jets lost last week, and the pattern with the Jets this year has been win-loss, 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 win-loss. They just finished a loss. I'm going to go with a win, probably by the spread, so probably by a field goal or less. They might be able to pull it out against Baltimore because Baltimore's not the same team as last year. Pittsburgh at Cleveland Browns. They're even. Pittsburgh's been doing a lot better these past few games than they have in the first few games, unlike Cleveland. So I'm going to go with Pittsburgh on this one. San Diego Chargers at the Kansas City Chiefs. A division game, always tough. Does Kansas City have the offensive firepower to keep rolling? I think they might. I would say let's go with Kansas City. We got Chicago Bears and St. Louis Rams. Also a very tough one. St. Louis has been all over the board. Chicago's been a little bit more consistent. But will St. Louis show up? I don't know. They might. I think Chicago will squeeze this one out. They can find a way to win. Minnesota Vikings at Green Bay Packers. Packers are at home. It's still the Packers. I think the Packers are finally going to figure out the backup quarterback's finally going to figure out the system a little bit and get more comfortable with it. I'm going to go with Green Bay Packers, even though I know they have no defense. Oh, man, they have no defense. Tampa Bay Buccaneers at Detroit Lions, the game of the week for us here in Tampa. Detroit is 10 points favorites over the Bucs. I don't know about that, folks. I could see Detroit by maybe three or maybe a touchdown, but we'll see. I think Detroit's probably going to pull it out. Like I said, I'm not convinced yet. I want to see consistency. Until I see consistency, I can't pick the Bucs. So Detroit. This pains me too. It really does. Jacksonville Jaguars over Houston Texans. That is going to be the NFL tailgate game of the week, and that's W-E-A-K, folks. W-E-A-K week, as in they can't do nothing. Texans. And they're 11-point favorites over the Jaguars. Two horrible teams. Carolina Panthers over the Miami Dolphins. I'm going to pick Carolina Panthers. Even though I know the Dolphins will be in it. They'll stay in it. Indianapolis Colts at Arizona Cardinals. Colts. Oakland Raiders at Tennessee. Tennessee at the Oakland Raiders. I'm going to pick Oakland. Dallas Cowboys at New York Giants. Ooh, this one's in New York, folks. I'm going to pick Dallas. Denver Broncos over the New England Patriots.
And I'm going to pick 49ers over the Washington Redskins. And that is the Tailgate Show this week, folks. Catch you in 2 weeks. We are off for Thanksgiving. Till then, ciao.
WTAN, Clearwater, Tampa Bay. WDCF, Dade City, Tampa Bay. WZHR, Zephyr Hills, Tampa Bay. Listen.